We've all witnessed the chaos that John Taffer brings to Bar Rescue. Health hazards that make you question humanity, drinks so terrible they should come with a warning label, and confrontations that could scare a bouncer.
You're the manager of this bar! How dare you disrespect that girl!
But those are just appetizers compared to the main course, the epic blowouts that go down on this show. We're talking fights that make you wonder if you're watching a bar makeover or the latest pay-per-view brawl. These clashes go way beyond your average barroom bickering. You know, when someone tells you they bought a bar with their inheritance money, you kinda hope for a feel-good story, right? Maybe something that is now a beloved local spot where everyone knows your name. But when John Taffer walked into Russell City Grill and Sports Bar, it was more of a disaster where the bartenders are brawling and the owner is blissfully ignoring the chaos.
In the whole wide world, and I lost my mother, my whole world really crashed. I was really going through it.
Welcome to Hayward, California, where one man's dream of owning a bar has turned into a breeding ground for chaos, with bartenders running amok, customers driven away, and the owner oblivious to the disaster unfolding before him. Here's the lowdown. Russell City Grill was owned by Lee Bellett, a construction worker who decided to dabble in the bar business back in 2014. The guy had a good start, raking in $50,000 a month, and since there was no competition around, things looked pretty rosy, sweet. But, and this was a big but, Lee had zero experience running a bar, and it showed. The business went downhill faster than a greased pig on a slide. Lee wasn't just some random guy who decided to blow his savings on a bar, he used money inherited from his late mother to buy the place. Talk about pressure, right?
If I don't fix this business, this is it. I'm done. Oh my God.
The business was originally purchased by Bill Kladakis back in 2003 and later taken over by his son Manny and daughter Anna. Unfortunately, after Bill's passing in 2015, the bar faced a grim turn of events during the Deepwater Horizon oil spill.
You want to know why we didn't fix the floor?
Here, why didn't you fix the floor?
The impact hit hard since the Bridge Lounge was a fisherman's bar, resulting in major financial losses and leaving the establishment in a state of disarray.
I think that's like pretty, you know, seriously.
To assess the situation, Anna and her fiancé accompanied the renowned bar consultant, John Taffer, to take a good look at the troubled establishment.
She's worked up now. It's gonna take a lot to slow her down.
As part of their investigative efforts, they even sent in a spy to gather valuable insights. Now, brace yourself for some drama. The spies had quite the unpleasant experience when they finally received their drinks.
Is it normally like this in here?
Yikes. Turns out, they used expired orange juice in their cocktails. You know, in one of the four biggest orange-growing states in the country. As you do. But the drama didn't end there. Chrissy, another member of the Kladakis family, decided to confront Gary, the bar's manager, in a rather heated exchange.
It's a liability now. Are you insuring this
place? You want to see a liability? Here you go.
Their dispute revolved around a hazardous broken floorboard that posed a threat to the safety of the employees. Needless to say, tensions ran high during this intense argument. Both of them just couldn't resist trying to get the last word, but neither was willing to let it slide. It was honestly pretty annoying to watch.
Go in front of your customers, and your brother isn't doing anything about it.
So, here's the deal. Manny hired his friend Gary to manage the bar, but Chrissy was convinced that Gary was taking advantage of their friendship to make some extra cash. Now, here's where it gets interesting. Gary didn't seem bothered by the fact that there was a loose floorboard, and Chrissy wasn't impressed with his attitude at all. Things escalated pretty quickly when Chrissy finally blew up at Gary, and they both ended up having a big argument about all the issues at the bar.
You destroyed the bar. It never came out of your pocket. My mommy's struggling. You!
And get this. It all went down right in front of the customers who just wanted a nice drink.
Gone.
Bitch.
You're an idiot, man. Stop. You can say what you want about me.
Talk about unprofessionalism. Needless to say, those customers were definitely shocked by the whole drama.
Is it normally like this in here?
This isn't a liability.
As the argument continued to heat up, every person present there couldn't help but stare. I mean, it was an extremely uncomfortable situation. Since the tensions had escalated way too far, Manny seemed to be under a lot of stress. And to make things worse, guess what Chrissy did? This signaled to Taffer that it was time to intervene. Thankfully, the fight didn't go any further, and the situation was resolved without anyone's heads getting busted open. One would think he'd have taken extra care to keep things running smoothly, but nope. The bar staff had completely checked out, and walking into that place was like stepping into a circus where the clowns had taken over. There was no inventory, no tools, no management, just pure chaos. The staff? They weren't just unprofessional, they were downright reckless. These folks were so far gone they were taking shots with customers, playing dress up behind the bar, and doing everything but their jobs. That's some employee-customer relationships.
bartenders drinking more than the customers are.
And then there was Lee's buddy, Church. If the staff was bad, this guy was on another level. Church was that one friend everyone warned you about, but no one ever listened. He was the guy who thought it was totally okay to hop behind the bar and make his own drinks. He wasn't just a nuisance, he was a full-blown menace. And Lee? He just stood there letting it all happen, like a deer caught in headlights. Church's antics drove paying customers away, and it was no wonder who wanted to stick around when a fight could break out any minute. And oh, does a fight break out. One night, Church decided to get his hands dirty, literally, by jumping behind the bar to mix his own drink. El Boogie, one of the bartenders, wasn't having it. El Boogie might have been slacking on the job before, but this was the last straw. He stepped in to stop the Church, and things went from zero to chaos in seconds. Glasses started shattering, equipment got tossed, and the whole place turned into a battleground. It was like the Wild West, but with less honor and more tequila. This wasn't some bar fight fantasy, this was just straight up uncomfortable. And you know, it's bad when the police have to be called to break it up. Yeah, the police. The place was such a disaster that the only way to stop the madness was to get the law involved. If that doesn't scream, we need John Taffer. I don't know what does. John arrives with his usual flair, and he's got his expert bartender Lisa Marie Joyce and chef Aaron McCargo in tow. These two are the real deal, and they're about to see just how deep the rabbit hole goes. The recon reveals everything you'd expect, and worse, the place is a mess. The bartenders are unprofessional, and the kitchen is a health hazard. Sherry, the cook, is drowning in grease traps and raw chicken, while Lee is busy playing pool, oblivious to the chaos around him. Way to go, Lee! When John finally sits down with Lee, you can almost see the steam coming out of his ears. He's disappointed, and who wouldn't be? Lee has let his friends run the place into the ground, and the fight with Church was the cherry on top of this rotten cake. John doesn't mince words. Lee needs to get his act together, or this bar is toast. And this is where things start to get real. John forces Lee to face the harsh reality he's been taken advantage of, and it's time to make some tough decisions. Lee finally fires El Boogie and bans Church from the bar for good.
No more. You get the out of here. Come on.
It's a move that's long overdue, but you can tell it's not easy for Lee. He's lost control of his bar, and now he's got to take it back, one painful step at a time. With this, John Taffer probably thought he'd seen every train wreck a bar could be. Grimy kitchens? Check. Disorganized owners? Double check. Staff who couldn't pour a drink if their lives depended on it? Oh, that's old news. But when he rolled up to O-Face Bar in Council Bluffs, it was a whole new level of chaos, the kind that makes you wonder how the doors stayed open for as long as they did.
To make matters worse, manager Amanda displays a total lack of professionalism.
Owned by Karen and Matthew Overmeyer, a married couple who seemed more interested in orchestrating a circus than running a business, O-Face Bar was a disaster waiting to happen. They'd poured their retirement savings into the place, naming it after Matt's nickname, O-Face, a cheeky little nod that probably seemed clever after a few too many drinks. The locals loved it at first. The bar was raking in $15,000 a month, and Karen and Matt probably thought they were living the dream. But you know what they say, easy come, easy go, and boy did it go. Success went straight to their heads, and the bar quickly spiraled into a chaotic, booze-fueled nightmare. Karen, the so-called manager, was drinking more than she was managing, while Matt partied like a college kid on spring break. Their staff? Well, they weren't much better, turning the place into a free-for-all rather than a functioning business. By the time John Taffer stepped in, the bar was hemorrhaging $4,000 a month, drowning in a sea of $260,000 in debt, and the Overmeyers were just 3 months away from losing everything. John, never one to waste time, brought in his expert mixologist Russell Davis to help assess the situation, or should I say, get a whiff of it. From the outside, O-Face Bar looked more like a sad trailer park reject than a respectable drinking hole. And the inside? Even worse. John's first impression wasn't just bad, it was one of the worst he'd ever had, and that's saying something. It didn't take long to figure out that the bar was less about service and more about self-service. The staff was too busy partying in the back to bother with customers, and when they finally did serve a drink, it came in some nasty reused plastic container that looked like it had seen better days. A long time ago. The real kicker in this circus of a bar was the absolute lack of professionalism among the staff. Karen, the owner, seemed more invested in ringing a bell for free shots than noticing that her bartenders were either missing in action or, even worse, actively sabotaging the business. It was like she was the captain of a sinking ship, but too busy throwing a party to notice the water pouring in.
A lot of times, Karen, she'll want a drink, she'll sit there and ding, 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 ding.
Take Dave, for instance, one of the bartenders who decided to play with fire, literally, by serving flaming drinks all wrong. I mean, it's one thing to have flair, but it's another to turn the bar into a potential crime scene.
And I was like, "Oh!"
And if that wasn't enough, another poor customer had to mix her own drink because, surprise, no one was around to do it for her. This place wasn't just a mess, it was a lawsuit waiting to happen. Things took a dramatic turn when a simple argument between Matt, bartender Sarissa, and manager Amanda escalated into a full-blown brawl. It kicked off when Matt, already on edge from who knows what, flat out refused to tell a customer how much alcohol was in a specialty shot. This ticked off Sarissa, who had just about enough of the lack of transparency and professionalism. She wasn't gonna let this slide. And then Amanda jumped in, and before anyone could say oh face, fists were flying.
And they're really beating the hell out of each other.
It's a full-blown catfight.
Now, let's pause for a second. Imagine being John Taffer sitting in your SUV, watching this mess unfold on the surveillance cameras. One minute you're mentally mapping out how to save this train wreck, and the next, you're racing out of the car to break up a catfight in the parking lot. Talk about hitting a new low. When John intervened, Amanda's attitude was anything but apologetic. She was defiant, disrespectful, and completely out of line, everything you don't want in a manager. John, being the no-nonsense guy he is, gave the Overmyers an ultimatum. Fire Amanda, or he'd walk away.
You're the manager of this bar! How dare you disrespect that girl!
Matt, who had clearly had enough of Amanda's antics, was all for it. But Karen, in a classic display of misplaced loyalty, wanted to keep her. So, in a move that defied all logic, they decided to fire Sarissa instead. The one person who had the guts to stand up for what was right. But John wasn't about to let them off that easily. The next day, when he walked into the bar and saw Amanda still there, he lost it. John's not a guy who likes to repeat himself, and seeing that the Overmyers had ignored his clear directive pushed him over the edge. He walked out, leaving the staff scrambling to figure out what to do next. Realizing they had no other choice, they finally fired Amanda. But by this point, the damage was done. John returned, reluctantly, and the staff begged him for another chance. It was clear they needed his help, but John wasn't about to let them off the hook without some serious changes. And just when you thought things couldn't get more chaotic, Karen decided to stir the pot by accusing Matt of drinking on the job right in front of John. It was like watching two kids tattle on each other in the principal's office, except these kids were supposed to be running a business. John called Karen out on her behavior, labeling her as obnoxious, which she didn't take well. At this point, John had seen enough. The Overmyers had crossed the line in more ways than one, and John wasn't about to put his reputation on the line for a bar that was beyond saving. And so, he walked out again, but this time for good, leaving the Overmyers with a few choice words of advice: seek counseling. And just like that, John Taffer left O'Face Bar without a rescue and probably with a sense of relief that he didn't have to deal with that mess any longer. But don't think this is all buckle up for a bar rescue where all hell breaks loose in the most unexpected ways. Ever wondered what happens when a bar owner's last-ditch efforts to save his failing business spiral into chaos? Zanzibar's wild ride is about to hit a fever pitch. The owner goes from desperate to downright explosive, and it all culminates in a showdown that's anything but ordinary. When things get so out of control that fists start flying, including a jaw-dropping altercation with John Taffer himself, you know it's gonna be a ride you won't forget.
You said free sex to my wife.
Zanzibar was the brainchild of Ami Benari, a man who ran the place like a general, but with a heart that, in the beginning, seemed to be in the right spot. Ami wasn't just another bar owner trying to make it big, he was a guy who had seen some pretty serious stuff. After serving in the Israeli army, Ami packed his bags and headed for Denver, where he opened Zanzibar in 2009, ready to conquer the nightlife scene. At first, things were looking pretty good. The bar was raking in around $38,000 a month, basically, it was the place to be. But then, life threw Ami a curveball. In 2011, a near-fatal car accident knocked him out of commission, and that's when the wheels started coming off. With Ami out of the picture, the staff went wild, turning Zanzibar into a mayhem. The customers got scared off, and the once thriving bar started spiraling. By the time Ami made his comeback, Zanzibar was bleeding cash, losing up to $3,000 every month. Ouch. So, what did Ami do? He decided to crack down on his staff with an iron fist, and oddly enough, started giving away free beer like he was channeling his inner Santa. As you might have guessed, this wasn't exactly a winning strategy. When John Taffer rolled up to the scene, it was obvious he was stepping into a war zone. The first sign of trouble? Ami standing outside hollering free beer to anyone who'd listen.
Come and get it! Free beer!
Now, let's be real, if the owner of a bar is out on the street handing out free dates like they're party favors, that's not exactly a good look. And yeah, John wasn't impressed either. Inside, the situation was spiraling into a frenzy. There was this drunken customer, already three sheets to the wind, hitting on a woman at the bar like he thought he was the king of charm. And what did the bartenders do? Oh, they just handed him another beer, because why not, right? Over-serving was practically the theme of the night, and not a soul in the place seemed to give a damn. Meanwhile, the kitchen was ground zero of chaos, cross-contamination running wild, with the cook coughing right into his gloves before diving back into the food prep. Disgusting doesn't even begin to describe it. Ernest John finally had enough of this circus and stormed into the bar, determined to lay down the law. He wasted no time tearing into the staff for letting customers drink themselves into oblivion, to the point where they were practically crawling out the door. And that kitchen? John didn't even hesitate. He ordered every last thing to be thrown right in the bin. Amy, trying to act like he still had control of the situation, declared that his cook, Dave, wouldn't leave until the kitchen was spotless enough to eat off the floors.
John was right, Dave is not going home today.
But that's when things really started to get spicy. Amy was already on edge, throwing his weight around, but John wasn't backing down. When John called him out for offering free sex to customers because, you know, that's such a stellar business plan, the tension shot through the roof.
Hey, cheap sex!
Who's gonna give us free sex? Us. We're not giving free sex.
That was it, the last straw. Amy couldn't handle the pressure any longer, so he bolted to the back of the bar and started hurling glass plates against the wall like a total madman.
That's how I feel. One more?
We're not talking about a minor temper tantrum here, this was a full-scale meltdown, the kind where you realize the person's gone completely off the rails. Amy wasn't just angry, he was in total denial, refusing to hear a word from anyone or own up to the chaos he'd unleashed. And then came the big showdown, the kind of moment where you just know everything's about to go haywire. John was already on his last nerve with Amy's stubbornness, refusing to face the reality right in front of him. But Amy crossed the line and called Chef Duff, Fat Boy, that was the moment when all bets were off.
The Fat Boy. Fat Boy should have stopped the kitchen long time ago.
Amy didn't just get mad, he went from zero to full-blown aggressive in seconds. Next thing you know, he's shoving John and taking wild swings at him. Now, John Taffer is no pushover, and we all know he's not one to back down from a confrontation. But even John knows when to cut his losses and get out of Dodge.
You disrespectful son of a bitch! Don't touch me!
After Ami's epic meltdown, John just told the staff goodnight and stormed out of the bar, probably thinking, if the rescue is even worth the headache. In the world of reality TV, these explosive moments are absolute gold. But in the real world, they're a glaring neon sign that things are seriously messed up. Ami's outburst wasn't just about the bar, it was about a guy who was way over his head, lashing out at anyone trying to help. And John saw that clear as day. Moving on to another crazy case on bar rescue. When the staff starts acting more like the customers, things go downhill fast. And let's just say, the chaos that erupts isn't your average bar drama. And so happened in the next bar. Tension boiled over and drinks kept flowing, the line between a fun night out and a total disaster got dangerously blurred. And trust me, what happens in the next bar crossroads, Grilly, is nothing short of explosive. Robert and Ashley Gaddy started their bar with the best of intentions, family recipes, and a whole lot of heart, which is usually a pretty solid foundation for success. They had their community backing them up, and things looked promising. But after an injury sidelined Robert, the bar went downhill fast. That's when everything started spiraling, and fast. Before they knew it, they were drowning in a staggering debt. And let me tell you, it wasn't just the finances that were out of control, the staff was a whole other nonsense. Now, this is where things really start to get interesting. We've got a bar that's teetering on the edge of disaster, but what really sends it over the cliff is the fight that erupts one night. The tension was so thick, you could practically see it hanging in the air. The staff, who should have been holding it together, seemed more like a rowdy bunch of partygoers than professionals. With nicknames like Cheeks, Bubbles, and Buns, it's hard to believe they were ever serious about the job in the first place. I mean, who wouldn't want to party all night with a name like Buns?
There's Buns, the bartender. There's Bubbles.
These bartenders were mixing drinks in a way that would make even the most tolerant health inspector cringe. I'm talking about literally pouring alcohol from one bottle into another, which, fun fact, is totally illegal. If that's not enough, the drinks are so inconsistent that a margarita ordered by the recon team changed color like a chameleon. But let's talk about the real showstopper when Buns, who seemed to have forgotten that she's at work and not at a frat party, smacked a customer on the arm. Now, we all know that bars can get a little rowdy, but there's a line and Buns didn't just cross it, she then cha-chas her way on it.
Be on my side, the
The first smack didn't seem to faze the customer too much, but when she went in for round two, things started to heat up, and what followed was crazy. The shouting match escalated into a full-blown confrontation with the other bartenders. The rest of the staff, already a few drinks deep, decide they're going to play peacemaker. But let's be real, it was like watching a bunch of tipsy toddlers trying to calm down a raging bull. Total chaos. Instead of defusing the situation, they're just stumbling around, making everything 100 times worse.
I'll be in the bitch up outside these motherfucking houses.
And just when you think this train wreck can't get any more out of control, they finally manage to drag Buns out of the bar, kicking and screaming like a banshee. I mean, it's a small miracle the walls were still standing after all this. Seriously, I half expected the place to implode right then and there.
Cash out and do what y'all want to do.
What did they do right?
Now, you've got to wonder, where are the owners in all this mess? Oh, they're there all right, standing off to the side, looking like they just walked into a horror movie. Their dream bar? Yeah, it's officially gone from Cheers to Nightmare on Elm Street.
Robert, you don't hear all this, and I'm yelling, and I'm listening.
The moment John Taffer walked in, you could practically feel the collective relief. Finally, someone was there to take the reins. John didn't waste a second. He tore into the staff, spelling out exactly how their antics have driven this bar straight into the ground. And honestly, they had it coming. Every single word he throws at them is like a truth bomb, and boy, do they need to hear it. The kicker? John reveals that the bar had lost $2,100 over one weekend from the staff drinking on the job. I mean, talk about shooting yourself in the foot. It's clear that the staff had zero respect for the business, and there was only one way to turn this place around, and John knew that was to make some serious changes. The next day, the reality of the situation sets in. The bar was a wreck, the kitchen was filthy, and the staff was still reeling from the previous night's drama. John stepped in and pointed out that the illegal practice of merging liquor bottles is just one of the many reasons the staff didn't respect the owners. But the drama wasn't over yet. Buns, completely unaware of the storm brewing around her, strolled into work like it's just another day. When she's called into the meeting with the owners, you could almost feel the tension in the air. She's fired on the spot, and honestly, it's a long time coming. This isn't the first time her drinking had caused problems, and the owners were finally doing what they should have done a long time ago, taking control.
You don't even know how to talk about it!
Look at this!
First, Justin Whitfield, the owner. Now, Justin wasn't your typical bar owner, he's a former stripper and bodybuilder. Yep, you heard that right. He opened the End Zone back in 2005, and at first, things were going great. Locals loved the place, and it was pulling in a cool $100,000 a month. But as with all good things, the success started to fizzle out when the workload became too much for Justin to handle on his own. Enter Sean, Justin's buddy and partner in crime. Sean was also a former stripper and, for some extra spice, an MMA fighter. You'd think with that background, these two would be an unstoppable duo, right? Wrong. They couldn't see eye to eye on pretty much anything, and it didn't help that Justin had this brilliant idea of letting the bartenders drink behind the bar. Yeah, because nothing says professional like your staff downing shots while on the clock. Naturally, this led to a toxic environment where the staff was just as argumentative and divided as the owners. So, of course, the bar was in debt, and that's where John Taffer came in, ready to do what he does best, whip this place into shape. He rolled in with his expert team, Chef Vic Vegas and mixologist Kate Gerwin. They immediately saw potential. The bar was in a prime location, surrounded by 10 professional and college stadiums. But the exterior? Dead. The name? Not exactly screaming, "Come in and have a great time." It just blended in with the surrounding mall, making it easy to miss. John's got a couple of spies to sample the service and see just how bad things really are. And boy, do they get an eyeful. The dynamic between Justin and Sean? Toxic, to say the least. John pointed out the ownership drama, with Justin's wife Dana and Sean's wife Stephanie also working at the bar, adding more fuel to the fire. Then there was Taylor, the bartender. The spies ordered some drinks from her, and they're so bad and sour that they had to reorder. Not a great start. They also ordered a pizza and burger, and that is where things really start to go downhill. Kevin, the cook, was working in a kitchen that looked like it hadn't seen a good cleaning in months. He was handling meat with his bare hands and cross-contaminating everything in sight. It's a health inspector's nightmare. Meanwhile, Kiana, another bartender, was throwing back drinks and cursing in front of customers like it's no big deal. The floor of the bar? Sticky enough to trap a mouse. It's clear that basic hygiene wasn't a priority here. Then the food came out and John had to warn the spies not to eat it. That's how bad it is. But just when you think it can't get any worse, the male strippers took the stage. Yep, you read that right. customers came in expecting a sports bar experience, and instead, they were treated to a strip show. And who do you think was leading the charge? None other than Justin, who decided to rip off his shirt and join in. You can almost hear the collective groan as customers start walking out in disgust. But here's where it gets real juicy. Taylor, who's loyal to Justin, started disrespecting Sean in front of everyone.
Told me she doesn't work for me, she works for Justin. That's what she just told me.
Sean's wife, Stephanie, wasn't having it, and before you know it, they were in a full-on physical fight. It's chaos.
Hey, you don't even know me, bitch! I don't care. I swear to God.
Sean got so upset, he was literally in tears, and then came the insane outburst. He smashed the computer screen and started throwing things around.
He's crying.
Finally, he confronted Justin, demanding that Taylor be fired and things escalate quickly. The two owners were up in each other's faces and it got physical. The staff has to step in to hold them back before it turns into an all-out brawl.
Side of me, now you're gonna get it, you chill the out.
John, watching all of this unfold, decided to skip the meeting that night. Everyone was too riled up, and it was clear nothing productive will come out of it. The next day, John finally sat down with the crew. Most of the staff didn't bother enough to show up on time, and when they did, it's obvious the teams were divided. Everyone had a different version of what happened, and it's a mess. Now, here's where the ownership drama really heats up. Sean was given 15% of the business, but there's no paperwork to back it up. Justin thought he was protecting Sean from the debt, but John steps in and clears things up. Papers can be drafted to protect Sean, but this misunderstanding has been a ticking time bomb. John's experts laid out all the issues. Staff drinking on the job, health code violations all over the place, and strip shows that had no business being in a sports bar. They dug into the kitchen, finding fryer oil that looks like it's been there since the bar opened. Grease traps overflowing, and chicken wings soaking in blood. Over at the bar, there were fruit flies buzzing around, standing water, and a draft system that was dirtier than a gas station bathroom. The team starts cleaning, but, of course, more drama flares up. Kevin wanted an apology from Sean before he even considered getting that contract signed. This conflict just kept dragging on, and as a result, the cleaning barely got done. When John and his experts returned, they were furious to find the place still filthy, and the staff still bickering about the contract. Finally, they got the bar somewhat cleaned up, and training began. Then came the stress test. Customers flooded in, and it was chaos from the start. The bartenders were slow, meats was burning in the kitchen, and tickets were piling up. Wait time stretched to 18 minutes, and when the food finally came out, it was a mess. Tables weren't labeled properly, and Kevin and Sean's lack of teamwork was painfully obvious. John had to shut down the stress test because, honestly, nothing improved. Afterwards, there was luckily some praise for Kevin and Sean's hard work in their respective areas, but the bartenders got a stern reminder to treat customers better. The next day, John watched as the ownership paperwork finally got sorted out, and Kevin and Sean buried the hatchet. And that's a wrap on the biggest fights on bar rescue. Which one of these bars do you think eventually turned profitable in the long run? And which fight made you almost jump from your chair? Make sure to let me know in the comments. And if you enjoyed the videos, make sure to drop a like, subscribe, and turn on my post notifications. And if you want to keep the entertainment going, then don't forget to check out the next video right here. It's even crazier.